Do you want to become smarter?
Well, kids, I present to you
physics, the smartest subject out there, even though it makes me miserable. But also, I've been imprisoned in my house for 5 months. My last shreds of sanity have abandoned me. So, I decided to shove all my physics knowledge in this poorly composed video before I forget it all, since I'm taking physics again next year because I hate being mentally stable. Welcome to... New kinematics. Boosh, boosh, boosh. Pretty much describes things moving. There's a bunch of formulas, and all you do is plug shit in, and bam, numbers. Scalar quantities measure magnitude. That's stuff like distance and speed. Vector quantities measure magnitude and direction. That's stuff like displacement, how much stuff moves. Velocity, how fast stuff moves. And acceleration, how much speed increases. Direction is determined by the reference frame, which is just which way you view positive and which way you view negative. These things are not set, so you can make them up yourselves. But using the XY plane is probably the easiest way to go, and that's what I use, so that's what I'm gonna be using throughout this video. If an object's velocity increases, acceleration is in the direction of motion. If the object's velocity decreases, acceleration is the opposite direction of motion. That's all 1D kinematics. Now we have 2D kinematics. Best way to model this is throwing shit through the air. When something's flying through the air, it's moving in both the x and y direction. Treat them separately for calculations. The x direction has constant velocity because there's no force to change the speed. Like, you have the initial force when you throw the thing, and while it's flying, there's really nothing pushing it horizontally. Unless you hit it, or it hits something. On the other hand, the y direction has acceleration. And since this thing's flying through the air, acceleration stays the same. 9.8, baby. Or negative 9.8 if you have going towards Earth as a negative direction. Here's an example to reinforce the concepts. Plane. Plane zoom through sky. Plane drop baby. How will baby travel? Well, it'll move like this. There's horizontal movement because the plane was moving, so the baby will move with the same amount of velocity horizontally. And you can do the math yourself with the kinematics equations. If some person decides to ruin your day by launching objects at an angle, well, guess that sucks for you. I'm just kidding. Use trig. Ha 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 ha. Favorite thing in the world. Yuck. And then you solve any value you need with these new velocity values. There's also graphs for all these motions. Whoa. Wow. A big thing to remember, because text makers, for some dumb reason, really love asking this question using this concept. Displacement is equal to the area under a velocity versus time graph. Dynamics. Forces are so cool. Whoa. See, I dislike dealing with forces. Unless it's the one pulling me towards you. Forces describe interactions between two or more objects. You've heard of Newton's three laws. First law. In an inertial reference frame, the sum of the forces causes a system to accelerate. Definition time, because physics has too many goddamn vocabulary words. A system is essentially what you care about in a reference frame. So I could be looking at a scenario and be like, the only thing I care about in this whole picture is, I don't know, this microwave. And everything else is irrelevant, and usually the problem will tell you what to focus on, so just read the problem. If there's no unbalanced forces, the object will not change its motion. It'll just continue on its merry way. It does not mean the object's not moving. Second law. Total force is equal to mass times acceleration. Pretty self-explanatory. Third law. For every force applied, there's equal and opposite force applied back. There are types of forces. One's exerted by something external, like someone pushing a microwave side to side. And another one is also external, so I don't know why I said external before. It's different because it's not a contact force. And it's exerted by a big ball. Not balls. Just a ball. Now laugh. Gravity. Ever wonder why two very different objects can land on the ground at the same time? Well, there's this thing called a gravitational field, which is 9.8 newtons per kilogram. And essentially, it's this big force field, so we don't fly off Earth's surface. Any objects at a distance near Earth's surface all experience the same amount of acceleration. Unless you're in a rocket or something, I don't know. To better show the situation, let's say Bernard is standing on a roof, which is 4 meters above the ground. He's holding a banana and my computer. He drops them both, and they'll hit the ground at the same time. Let's see why by solving how much time it takes for each object to hit the ground. And oh wait, look! There's no mass, so it's fucking irrelevant. Just remember that no matter how fat an object is, it'll all hit the ground at the same time. This applies for things like projectiles, too. If you launch a banana off a table with a rubber band and drop another banana at the same time from the same height, they'll plop on the ground at the same time because X and Y are independent. There are exceptions, though. Like a feather or a piece of paper, just imagine you drop them, they'll fall slowly, right? Well, that's because they experience this thing called air resistance. Just imagine air resistance is having tug of war with Earth, and he's losing. This leaves the object with a smaller acceleration, meaning that it'll take longer to fall to the floor. So in summary, things with a lot of surface area and are super light in density have air resistance because they fall slower and because they have a decreased acceleration. Wow! That's a sick segue to free body diagrams. Every system can be drawn with a free body diagram. Let's start simple. Human, microwave. Unless I ignore the fact that it's completely out of proportion. I'm not even looking at the graphic. Why am I making that joke? Anyways, human pushes microwave to the right, which I'm going to say is the positive direction because I'm God now. And because I'm God, I'm going to dictate that the system be the box. So that's all we care about. Fuck the person pushing it. Ignore him. Steps to draw these ugly things are: step one, draw a dot. Step two, draw arrows for all the forces. And well, bam, your free body diagram. The arrow to the right represents the human pushing the box to the right. Well, yeah. The down arrow represents Earth's force pulling downwards on the object, also known as weight. The upper arrow exists because Newton's third law said so. Earth is pulling down the box, so the floor is pushing it back up because it doesn't move in the y direction. Thus, the balanced forces. This upward arrow is known as normal force, which is fancy for arrow perpendicular to the force the object is touching. Now let's add a bit of resistance. This creates friction. And the easy way to remember where to put the arrow for a friction or free body diagram is that friction goes in the opposite direction of motion. So the arrow for this scenario will be pointing towards the left since the object's moving towards the right. So I'm a dumbass and I forgot to talk about frictional forces. There's static friction, there's kinetic friction. Imagine you're dragging a frog with a leash. Static friction is a range of values while pulling on the frog, but it doesn't move. The max value for static friction is the value right before it begins moving. Kinetic friction is a constant value, and it's less than the max static friction value. These frictional values are known as the coefficient of friction, and it ranges between 0 and 1, though it can be greater than 1. 0 means there's no friction, which is ideal, but it doesn't exist in real life. 1 means that's rough, buddy. This is the equation to solve for the magnitude of friction. Now you may be asking,
how do I know how big to make these arrows?
The length of these arrows depend on the magnitude of the force. If this microwave has positive acceleration, meaning it vroom faster to the right, the arrow will be longer than the left one because you need an unbalanced force for acceleration to occur. And this applies to any direction. Also, just a friendly, non-threatening note, on a free body diagram, it just shows the forces. So you can't tell how the object's moving based on these diagrams. Look at this. For any free body diagram with arrows that are equal in opposite directions, it's either not moving or it's moving at constant speed. How about this diagram? Which way is it going? Pretty much in this scenario, the box is slowing down. Okay, I'm tired of frick, I can't even say the word. Momentum. This is where boom, boom, bam, bam, hitting stuff comes in. Momentum is equal to mass times velocity. Whenever you see a problem involving stuff hitting each other, it's probably momentum. Momentum is always conserved when the objects that collide are considered to be a part of a system. Example problem. Bernard has a 9-kilogram watermelon and rolls at 5 meters per second towards a 20-kilogram lamp wearing Heelys. When the watermelon hits the lamp, it bounces back at 2 meters per second, and the lamp starts moving in the opposite direction. To calculate the speed the lamp's moving at, it's easiest to define the system as both of these objects and do the math. And I'm finding right as the positive direction because, yeah. Impulse. If any force hits an object and it's not considered part of the system, momentum is not conserved. The change in momentum is called impulse. Impulse can be calculated two ways, multiplying the force by the amount of time the collision took, or multiplying the mass by the change in velocity. Impulse can also be determined by finding the area under a force versus time graph. Momentum, just like kinematics, can be two-dimensional, and pretty much is solved in the same manner as 2D kinematics. Break it down into the x and y direction, the initial x and the final x direction momentum should be equal, same with the y axis. Usually these problems are using billiard balls or pool balls or, yeah, balls. Ball hit ball and goes at angle. Use the value for each respective plane and make sure the initial and final momentum are equal for each respective direction. Also, collisions can be categorized as either elastic or inelastic. Elastic collisions mean kinetic energy before and after the collision are the same. Inelastic collisions mean the kinetic energy after the collision goes down and they stick together. Energy! Something I can only get through caffeine, except I hate coffee because that stuff tastes disgusting. You've heard of this before. Kinetic and potential energy. There's two kinds of potential energy though. One's big ball energy, known as gravitational potential energy, and one's boing boing energy, known as elastic potential energy. These values are conserved unless an external force acts upon an object. This change in energy is known as work. Work is calculated by multiplying the force by however much the object moves parallel to that force. Let's see some scenarios of work versus no work. Work, no work. Work, no work. If an object increases kinetic energy, there's positive work. If an object decreases kinetic energy, there's negative work. Net work can be found with the change in kinetic energy. Earth can do work if it's acting as an external force, but if it's part of a system, you can use gravitational potential energy. And also my elbow really hurts. Ow. Ugh. Mechanical energy is adding potential kinetic energy. If no external forces act on the object, then it always stays the same. Say Bernard is on the top of a slide. He has gravitational potential energy. Now he slides. Gravitational potential energy turns into kinetic energy. This is all conserved. The total energy at any point on the slide stays the same. Now if you had to find the final speed of Bernard, you can just set the initial potential energy equal to the final kinetic energy. Because at the bottom of the slide, there's no more potential energy since it's all converted into kinetic energy. And then if you do some math magic, you have a very cool equation to find the speed of stuff at the bottom of slides of ramps. Really useful for life, I know. The object itself can't store potential energy. Circular motion. I have a personal vendetta against circles. They suck. But putting that aside, here are all the equations for a uniform circular motion, which is just fancy for move around a point at the same speed. Say we have a merry-go-round, but instead of riding horses or whatever animal, you have to run. One child at this distance, and another child at this distance. Is this child abuse? Maybe. The child farther away from the center has to run faster in order to keep in line with the child closer to the center. The child near the center can be walking while the child outside has to run for their dear life. I hope that helped you visualize why a greater radius results in greater tangential velocity. Stuff involving angular speed and all that can be solved through dimensional analysis, where you just keep multiplying and canceling stuff until you get the units you need. Yeah, that thing. Even if something's moving at constant speed around something else, there's acceleration, and it's always pointing towards the center. So for this scenario, the free body diagram would look like this. Circular motion depends on forces too. For example, if Bernard got bored and became a cowboy who yeehawed with a yo-yo, these would be the forces. And the force keeping in the yeehaw motion is centripetal force. Side note, the tension of the string varies at different points of the circle, but centripetal force will always remain the same. It'll be less on the top and more on the bottom, since gravity is helping the yo-yo stay in circular motion while it's at the top. If you did it too aggressively and oops, string break, the yo-yo goes this way. There's also these things called banked curves. New. And since these use inclines, let's quickly understand how ramps work. This is ramp. We have weight, and you know how we have that X and Y plane? Yeah, let's just rotate that shit. Chip chop force earth into components. Components are just horizontal and vertical arrows that make up a vector. Just like force earth here, any vector can be broken down into components. I use the tip tail method. I don't really know what it's called. Screw the name, but I just start at the tail end of vector and draw arrows until I make it to the freaking pointy arrow part of the vector. This is why I'm not teaching vector addition or subtraction. The vertical component of force earth is balanced with normal force because the object's not flying off the ramp in this direction. And the horizontal component of force earth, which is parallel to the ramp, is what causes the object to go whoosh whoosh on the ramp. Generally, ramp arrows break down always seem to be the same, but you should just pretend to understand what's going on. Very cool. Now back to banked curves. Unlike ramps, normal force is greater than the weight of the object on the banked curve because it's the resultant vector of the y component of weight and the centripetal force which keeps it moving around the curve, and I just read that and had no idea what I said, but I hope it made sense. Pretty much smash this arrow and this arrow together. And there's many other things for banked curves, but I hate them so much, so I suggest to you that you pray that you understand and never see these problems. But here's a diagram. Hope it helps. Rotational motion. Remember all the child labor and angular stuff? Yeah, we just use those concepts. Circle. Point on circle's circumference. Angular position is measured by angles, and however many radians this point changed is the angular displacement. The units are usually in radians. This is positive, this is negative. The direction for positive and negative are like adding and subtracting degrees on the plane. When something's rolling and it doesn't slip, meaning that it's rolling and not skidding or whatever, it's always rolling, you calculate linear speed with this equation. So stuff like how fast car vroom vroom with a certain sized wheel, yeah, that stuff. Use that equation. Torque. It's what makes stuff spin. Say we have a bar and an axis. This bar can spin. If you apply a force perpendicular to the bar, it will spin. Wow, physics, I know, right? If you apply a force at the same magnitude closer to the axis rotation, it will spin less than before, and you need more force to get it to spin to the same speed as the first time. Here's force that is not perpendicular to the bar. The lever arm, or moment arm, whatever they're synonymous, is found by drawing the force out, like extending it outwards. So here is an imaginary line. Now start the axis and draw a line so these two lines will form a perpendicular intersection. And abracadabra, that line sticking out from the axis is your lever arm. I never used this method before, but maybe it makes sense to you. The way I solved this was drawing the components of torque and using the components that are perpendicular to the thing it's being applied to, and I just did math with that. Don't know if that made any sense, but that's how I did it. And also it had less lines to draw, so that's why I preferred it. Equation to find the magnitude of torque is perpendicular radius times force or perpendicular force times radius. Depends which method you like better. moment of inertia, or rotational inertia, whichever you prefer. Inertia's formal definition is tendency to resist change in motion, but what the fuck does that even mean? I don't know. Just nod your head in agreement and pretend to understand. Rotational inertia is determined by the composition of the object. When there is more mass concentrated away from the axis, it has a greater tendency to resist change in motion. And there's definitely equations for each shape, because... look at that. Wow. So cool. Amazing. Fabulous. Delicious. I'm so hungry. Why am I doing this? I hate my life. But a lot of time, they'll ask you to rank based on moment of inertia, and they won't give you the equation. And my brain melted trying to understand what was happening. But here is my two cents and how I thought about these problems. I'm a just swiper, no swipey, a problem from my textbook. Here is ramp. We have a ring, an empty soup can, a D-cell, a marble, and a soap bar. These lovely assortment of items are released at the same time. The round objects roll without slipping, while the soap slides with no friction. The order at which these land at the bottom is box, marble, cylinder, soup can, ring. The ring is the slowest because all the mass is away from the axis when it's rotating, so it will have the most amount of resistance to begin its rolling. The soup can's next because it's pretty much like the ring, but there's some mass at the axis because there's a lid and a bottom, but most of it's still concentrated away from the axis. Next is the solid cylinder, and because mass is evenly distributed, there's some mass at the axis and some away, and it's like more mass is at the center than the soup can. Next is the marble, and it's fastened in the cylinder because it's a sphere, and generally the mass is closer to the axis, whereas in the cylinder, it's a long boy. And lastly, the soap. It has no friction, so no resistance. Here's a video demonstrating moment of inertia. That probably renders my explanation useless, but I hope it helped. Newton's second law equivalent for rotation is net torque is equal to g times inertia. Angular momentum. The equation is inertia times angular velocity, and an additional way to solve net torque is with this. A typical example for angular momentum is with figure skaters. They about to spin, arm out. When they go into air, arm in. They spin faster into air because rotational inertia is smaller, because more mass equals slow. And then more mass concentrated center towards the axis, you fast man now. And angular momentum concepts is just like linear momentum. Angular momentum is conserved if there's nothing interfering. So if inertia goes down, the angular velocity goes up. And that's it. As for stuff like electricity, waves, and whatever else college board demands, well, I'm gonna have to reference you to the organic chemistry tutor or Khan Academy. I love this man. And they're much better anyways. Thanks for watching. Goodbye. Ah?